This is the MochaFootball.com. This is the MochaFootball.com. Okay, everybody, back again for week two. Really crazy week. There was a lot of, you know, really interesting things that happened week one. We're going to get into all that stuff, and we're going to talk about the game of the week this week. The King's Trophy is coming up, and also we're going to do our pick 'em. We're going to do, we're going to go to the boards a little bit, see what some of the fans have to say about some of the questions that the fans have about week one, and also going forward. So first and foremost, let's do a quick little review of last week. So Damon, first and foremost, we got to start off with the game of the week. Masters versus QO, the Masters heading over to Quinn Soldiers to the Cougar Dome, got that victory. Got the victory 21-13. QO was going down the field to try to tie the game, but ended up stalling in the red zone. I thought it was a really well played game. How do you see this game overall, and what were your impressions of both teams?
Well, first off, it was a excellent way to kick off the 2016 season in Montgomery County. Two of the premier programs going head to head to start the season, and it totally lived up to expectations.
Right.
The Cougar Dome was rocking. Damascus showed up in droves, so the atmosphere was electric, and it was a sight to see. As far as the game itself, I think both teams, all things considered, lived up to individual people's expectations. If we want to drill down on individual players, it all starts with Marcus Benson. He definitely showed out and showed why he is one of the top running backs in not only Montgomery County, but the state as a whole.
Right.
He ran for 270 yards, three touchdowns on 14 attempts, and that feeds right into what Damascus does and has been doing for the past several years. Line play was outstanding, opening up the holes for Marcus to burst through. And once he gets to that second level, all bets are off.
I had mentioned
last week when we were giving our predictions, if QO wanted to win that game, they had to contain Mr. Vincent. They did not do that at all.
And you also mentioned, and real quick, you also mentioned about the eye discipline that the linebackers for QO would have to have, and time after time after time again, they lost that, and that created seams for Marcus to get through. And anytime you create, even the I forgot who it was, I think it was Gale Sayers, 2 seconds, the smallest hole, he's gone. You know, so.
Yep. Absolutely. And on the other side of the ball, for Damascus to win the game, they had to keep Doc Bonner from going off, which they did for the most part, especially in the second half. In the first half, it wasn't all QO, but they were definitely dominating all aspects of the game. We got a chance to see the, I guess we can call it new QO offense.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely more pass-centric than it has been in well over a decade. I can't remember the last time a QO quarterback threw the ball 28 times.
Right.
For old school people like me, it's going to take some time getting used to, but I definitely liked what I saw.
Right.
Doc ended the day with 16 completions,
mm-hmm,
on 28 attempts, two touchdowns, 197 yards.
Mm-hmm.
Things kind of got tight in the second half. Damascus was make the adjustments at halftime to limit the offensive production, and if they could get some home runs on offense, which they did, then they definitely took over the game. But yeah, it was a great test for both teams to start off the season with, and I think both squads moving forward can feel good about their trajectory as they both drive toward their individual state title aspirations.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I mean, I think that QO just kind of fell victim to one of those, another one of those special performances by individual play. Last year was Jake Funk. I was going over 200 yards against them, and this year was the great Marcus Vinson, again, showing what kind of player he is. I haven't really seen too many players that fast in person. He really, once he got to the second level, he was gone. And that was, honestly, it got to a point where almost every single time he got the ball, it felt like he was going to go through the yard. Kiwo, honestly, given the circumstances, and we're going to get into that later, they really played well. It showed a lot of heart. Marcus did had a great game, but there was, you know, it really was on a bunch of big plays. There's a lot of times in that game where Kiwo was in the backfield doing their thing, the front seven, outside of the fact that they let up, you know, a few times they weren't disciplined in the gaps. I thought played a pretty good game. Noah Pegley definitely was a presence in the game, you know, getting into the backfield a few times. And I think that overall Damascus showed why they are Damascus, why they are the New England Patriots of Montgomery County. You lose a Jake Funk, you lose a Daquan Grimes, you lose a Jake Bradshaw, Delano Myers, those kind of guys, and you come back next year and you're able to do what they did last Friday. So, you know, they just showed, exemplified, you know, what we think about Damascus. And, you know, again, they're going to be a premier team in the 3A and to get back to the championship. QO, I don't think QO should hang their heads at all. They played well despite, like I said, having some issues, you know, going into the week and you know, some players not being there. So for them to take a championship caliber team like Damascus all the way to the brink of losing, I think is something that they definitely should hang their hats on going forward in the season. The other game that I wanted to kind of touch on from last week, and then now, you know, we're going to get into this week, is Paint Branch. And this might be one of the most surprising results I can remember the last, you know, 3 or 4 years. Paint Branch home opener. I predicted the game. I have egg on my face, honestly, because I think the score, my score was crazy. I think I said 56 to something, right? I mean Whitman, I apologize, you know, completely. And they ended up losing to Whitman 27-7. Gunnar Morton had a terrific game. He went over 200 yards, and just really they lined up in I formation, really pounded him, Damon. I mean as simple as that. And I just never thought that would happen. And you know, and to make matters worse, Matt Clayton, their best player for Whitman, was out with a concussion. So this was very surprising. Do you think this is a blimp on the radar for the Panthers, or you think that they're going to be able to bounce back next week versus Blake?
It's only one game. It's the first game of the season. I'm not going to ring the alarm just yet for the Paint Branch Panthers, but I am looking at them in my peripheral vision with a look of concern. Mm-hmm. Coming into the season, based off of what we had seen and heard, due to off-season workouts, 7-on-7 scrimmages, it was looking like Paint Branch had reached that point where even if they lose several key players to graduation, they're at the point where they can just reload with the talent that they built up in the pre previous years. For them, not only to lose to Whitman, but to get pretty much dominated.
Yeah.
I don't have the exact time of possession, but from what I heard, it was heavily, heavily in Whitman's favor. Even without the actual time of possession, you can kind of look at the stats and get a good idea of what's going on. Gunner, as you mentioned before, Gunner Martin had an outstanding game, 29 rushes, 224 yards, and 4 touchdowns. That's a lot of rushing attempts that eats up a lot of clock.
Yeah.
And even though Paint Branch runs a pretty high potent offense with quick strikes, for whatever reason, they just couldn't put it together. So the good news is it's early in the season.
Mm-hmm.
The bad news is with the region that Paint Branch is in.
Yeah.
We mentioned this a couple of weeks ago.
Oh yeah, yeah, it's huge. It's a huge loss.
Going 8-2.
Yeah.
You very well may be sitting at home.
Yeah.
Just ask Paint Branch from last year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So. There's no cause for panic yet, but there's definitely areas of concern that need to be addressed in Burtonsville if they want to make it back to the playoffs in 2016. Paint Branch coming up this week. Who are they playing? So it's not going to get any easier for the Panthers coming up this Friday as they take on a resurgent Blake program. They're one of the sleeper teams that we touched on earlier this year when we were talking about teams we think may surprise some people. And they came out the gate strong versus Springbrook. And with this being a neighborhood rivalry between Blake and Paint Branch, it's going to get real serious real quick. So whatever things Paint Branch needs to fix, they need to do it in a hurry and
right now,
with no time to waste.
Yeah,
because Blake is feeling themselves right now. So nobody wants to start the season 0-2 because that's. And with the 10-game schedule, that's a hole to dig out of, especially when you're in the same region as teams like Sherwood and Howard. So no panic yet, but I got my eye on Paint Branch.
No, absolutely. I mean, when you don't want to start the season 0-2, and then now you still got Sherwood and QO on the schedule, like
right.
That's just that would be. I don't know if I'm a kid, that would be hard for me to get over, but I mean, if anybody can do it, we all know that Coach Snead is one of the best coaches in the county, and I'm sure he's a guy that can rally the troops and get them back focused. Okay, everybody, we're here with Ty Mason, the do-it-all wide receiver, safety, a little bit of running back, a little bit of everything for the Blake Bengals. And Ty, thank you so much for coming on the podcast, man, and I appreciate you taking the time out. First and foremost, man, you guys had a huge, humongous victory versus Springbrook last week. And you really made a statement to the county. What was the mindset when you guys went into that game? Obviously, it's sort of a rivalry game, and you guys really wanted to kind of lay the hammer down. What was the mindset going into that game, and how did you feel about it afterwards?
Our mindset since last season ended was BPD, and BPD means big payback, and basically that's been our motto since we started practices in the spring. So first week, everyone knew that we had to make a statement because everyone expected us to lose the game. So we used that as motivation, and that helped a lot.
Right. No, absolutely. You actually called us out a little bit on Twitter, for making the wrong prediction, man. And, Springbrook was looked at as one of those teams that were an up-and-coming team. But you know, and you know, we took a lot of heat over the summer because we ranked a lot of you guys. You were a guy that was ranked in our top 25, along with your teammates, Jabari Jones and Max Temption. You know, we ranked a lot of you guys in the top 25, and a lot of people were wondering why we were ranking a lot of Blake kids that you guys didn't have the greatest season in the world last year. Why were we ranking a lot of Blake kids this year in the top 25 and in the tops in their position groups? But, you know, when you looked at your film, it was clear that you guys were, you know, some of the top players in the county. Knowing that you had that kind of talent coming back, was it an easy transition to say, okay, we should be one of the top teams in the county this year, and there's really no excuse why we can't be up there playing with whoever, you know, they're talking about?
Well, basically, we have a lot of good athletes, and basically all the things that we were missing were the little things, and once we got those, you know, fixed, that made a lot of things easier for us.
So what were some of those little things?
Just mental things, like sometimes because people go to Blake and, you know, a lot of people talk, like in the hallways or school, like, oh, you guys are going to lose and so-and-so, and stuff like that would get into our players' heads and they would kind of be not confident themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But this year, I think the one factor that helped us out the most is our confidence. Our confidence level is getting really high, and I think it's helping us on the field.
Yeah, talk about that for a second. Obviously, Coach Anderson is a confident coach. He's instilled that in you guys. Coach Dennis Harris is also on your staff as well. He's a confident guy. Talk about how the coaching staff has kind of instilled that level of confidence into you guys, saying, hey, you know, we know the history of Blake. We know, you know, that quote-unquote that it's not a power school, whatever the case may be, but that doesn't matter because we have the athletes on the field and we have the coaching staff to get it done.
Once he got the point through to us that we can beat all the people on our schedule, I think everybody just got it in their heads that, you know, it's going to be a lot easier than it was last year. Because we've all been putting in the work, so there should be no reason why we should have any problems during the season. As long as we apply the little things, we should be fine.
Right, absolutely, absolutely. And you're going into this week, you're facing Paint Branch. Paint Branch is a team that has kind of dominated the consortium over the last few years. It's a rivalry game. How do you feel about going into this week facing Paint Branch? Obviously, they're coming off a tough loss at home. You know, where's your confidence level? Obviously, you know, you guys are probably riding a high, but you know, when you look at film, when you're looking at the matchup, what are some of the things that you want to accomplish this week?
This week, the one thing that's been on my mind since the last time I was on the field, because the last time I played football,
right,
and the game was against Paint Branch, and that was the week that I got hurt.
Right.
I'm pretty confident going into this week. I think this week is probably, I'm going all out this week. I think my team is pretty confident as well. We've been watching film. We see a lot of weaknesses, though. So if we take advantage of those, then we should have a good week.
Right. No, absolutely. And you talked about your injury. And, you know, honestly, if it wasn't for your injury, I believe that a lot more people would be talking about you as one of the top players, not only in this county, but in the state. You actually bounced back from that and actually became a Division I athlete. Talk about that process, you know, getting hurt, you know, for the remainder of the season, and then bouncing back and actually earning a Division I scholarship and being committed to a Division I school now.
Well, I think the thing that set me out from a lot of players is on my film it showed that I play every play like it's my last one.
Right.
Being hurt, it did set me back a little bit, but I had no choice but to really bounce back and get my head up, because without a quick rebound, I don't think I would have been able to, you know, do what I did.
Right. No, absolutely, absolutely. And my final question is basically just kind of like an overall question. Clearly, you know, obviously you guys saw what Watkins Mill did last year and what Wheaton did last year and what Watkins Mill is doing this year. What's the end goal for Blake? What is the overall you know, goal? What are the things that you guys have in your mind? What are some of the accomplishments that you guys have in your mind that you guys are trying to reach? And what is a successful season for Blake?
successful season for Blake is to finish the season positive. We have not been to the playoffs in a couple years. That's definitely one accomplishment that we're looking forward to. We're really not worried about any team. We don't have a goal to beat any team. We just want to beat everybody.
Right.
I think the main thing that we want to do to the season is make it to the ship. That's all that's been on our mind. We've been working really hard lately, and I see a lot of Moco football is changing a lot right now.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, anything can happen. So we're taking, right. We're going to take our chance to just start.
Right. No, absolutely. Well, thank you so much, man, for joining the show, man. And, you know, I'm really interested. I'm a big fan of what you guys are doing. We're going to be definitely watching you guys.
All right. Thank you. I appreciate it.
No problem. So going forward, we're gonna talk about this week's game of the week. There's no debate as to you know what it is and you know basically the gravity of this game. This game has been one of the premier games forever, and we're talking about the King's Trophy. We're talking about Seneca Valley and Northwest. Northwest is going to be heading over to Death Valley this Friday to take on the Screaming Eagles. I mean, this is one of the games where, and I said it on Twitter, this is a whole town shuts down kind of game. You know, people, men, women, and children, everybody's going to be at this game. These are crosstown rivals. They don't like each other very much at all. You know, Seneca Valley has a long history of greatness, but Northwest has the recent history of greatness. So you got those two parallels going on. You know, obviously the departure of one of the greatest of all time, Mark Pierce. Northwest is obviously going to be trying to, you know, compensate for that. You know, Chris Kroddick is stepping in. Obviously, he struggled a little bit versus Gaithersburg last week. But he has two really, you know, great running backs behind him, in Khalil Owens and Juwan Ferrari. Those two kids right there are just, you know, two of the best in the county. And honestly, you can make the argument that that Germantown may have two of the top five running back duos in the state of Maryland. You know, with Juwan Ferrari and Khalil Owens at Northwest, and then of course we already know about the Thunder and Lightning of Felix Platt and Darius Golson. I mean, Felix Platt and Darius Golson kind of reminds me of the old Reggie Bush and Lindo White days back in USC. You know, that kind of Thunder and Lightning kind of combination. So you know, obviously Northwest is going to rely on that a lot. They have great players up front. Cole Trico, obviously, you know, is a great player, and they got a bunch of other guys up front that can play. As for Seneca, I mean, Seneca Valley, they what they were supposed to do last week. You know, they beat Poolsville 42-20. Along the lines of what we kind of predicted. Felix Platt had a great game. Darius Golson also had a great game. I think Felix Platt is going to be in the running for All-County Player of the Year. And I think that this is a show. I think that this could be a showcase game for him. I think that he's going to be a kid that is going to take it upon himself to try to make sure that this game goes in the favor of Seneca Valley Screaming Eagles. I think that Seneca's defense last year was the difference in the game. I think that Seneca was really physical with Northwest last year. I think that affected Northwest a little bit. Now, Northwest still was able to mount some kind of, I guess a comeback, if you will. But still, you know, they were able... Seneca was really able to get into Northwest's grill and, you know, kind of rattle them a little bit. And the last point I'm going to make about this game is I'm really interested to see how Zach Robinson is going to play. Zach Robinson is a talented kid. He's easily a top five talent when it comes to the quarterbacks in his county. He is trying to reimmerse himself as one of the top players in this county, not only just quarterbacks. And this is a game to do it. If you're going to make a name for yourself or reemerge your name to the forefront, this is the game to definitely do it. So, Damon, talk about this game real quick. What are some of the things that you're going to be looking at, you know, as far as this game and what are the keys for both teams to win going forward?
So, yeah, as you mentioned, the Northwest Seneca Valley rivalry is one of the biggest rivalries in the county. Both schools separated by less than a mile. A lot of these kids grew up together, played junior league football together, and in some instances, some have even spent time at each other's school. So even family members. So it's a good, true local rivalry. As for the game itself, I expect it to play out somewhat similar to last year. I think it'll be a defensive battle.
Mm-hmm.
But this year, it's going to come down to the backfield play for both offenses.
Right.
For Seneca Valley, they kicked off the season with a strong win over Poolsville, 42-20.
Mm-hmm.
Adrian Platt and Darius Golson scored two touchdowns apiece, combined for over 200 yards. It was a great showing by the Seneca Valley offense. If they can keep this up for the remainder of the season, they're well on their way to what I think and believe will be a strong playoff run. As you mentioned, for Northwest, things started off a little bit shaky versus Gaithersburg. They were able to put it together toward the end of the game. As you mentioned, Mark Pierce has basically been running the show for the past 3 years, so this is somewhat of a new territory for a lot of the players at Northwest, especially on offense. With that being said, they still got the job done. They're still one of the top six teams in Montgomery County, and I expect them to remain that way for some time, especially with players on their squad, such as Khalil Owens. He's a super dynamic player, and I expect him to have much better games than what they showed in week one versus Gaithersburg. Mm-hmm. With all that being said, I'm going to have to go with Seneca Valley winning the King's Trophy for the second year in a row.
So you're expecting Seneca Valley to get it. What's the score, you know, that you're looking at right now, Dave?
Right now, I'm looking at it. Seneca Valley 27, mm-hmm. Northwest 14.
Okay. I'm going to go with, I'm also going to go with Seneca Valley. You know, they have more experience. They're a little bit more seasoned. I think that Northwest is still kind of trying to figure out what they're going to be this season, and that's not always the greatest thing to do going into Death Valley with a seasoned Seneca Valley team. Coach Kim's going to have those guys ready. I'm going to say that this game is going to be a close game. I think it's going to be a close, good, low-scoring game, and I'm going to go with Seneca Valley 17, Northwest 10. I think that's pretty much what is going to happen. I think it's going to be a defensive battle. And I think that Seneca Valley is going to come up on top. I think that it's going to be very similar, where there's going to be a big play then in the game to swing in Seneca Valley's favor. All right, everybody, we're back. We got a new segment here. We're going to call it Going to the Boards. And what we're basically going to be doing is we're going to go to the we got a thread up, Anybody can go to mocofb.com, go to our thread. We got great fans, so we kind of want to integrate them into the show a little bit. So they did a good job posting some questions for us, Damon. Got us thinking a little bit. The first question, first person we're going to go to is Amataragi, all one word. We're gonna go with this poster's question. First and foremost, what team does Kevin support the most? You know, anybody that knows. Yeah. Anybody that knows me, I mean, come on, man. Look at the Aggie. Look at the Aggie. I mean, I'm sure with blue. I mean, all the way down to my underwear, man. Like, you know, I'm sure with blue all the way everywhere. Sherwood, period. Point blank.
Fly them colors.
Listen, man.
Fly them colors, son.
Listen, man. That's what it is. I grew up in the Oney area, and you know I'm a Sherwood guy. So that's pretty much what it is. Which school do you think will be the biggest surprise of the season? That's the next question. That's a good question. I'm gonna go with Blake. I think that Blake is gonna be the biggest surprise this season. You know, I think that they clearly made a statement in week one. Who do you think is going to be the biggest surprise?
I mentioned this earlier this year, and I went with Blake, and I'm still riding with them, at least for the next few weeks, to see how that plays out. But based off of the week one fallout and everything that we've seen, you might have to keep an eye on Whitman. Like, seriously.
That's a good one.
We'll have a good idea coming in next week if they can knock off perennial IAC private school power Landon,
right?
Which is also a neighborhood rivalry. They might make a run for the playoffs. No. So we'll see. So Whitman has definitely got my attention.
Right. No. Absolutely. That, I mean, when you have a win like that, that's definitely something that is gonna get your attention. Next poster, we're gonna go to a consistent person, somebody that's been a seasoned vet when it comes on to the old board and the new board. Spread offense. He's a guy that has a lot of great knowledge about the games and a lot of teams in Montgomery County, specifically Paint Branch. His question that we're going to go with is, who will be the first MoCo running back to rush for 1,000 yards this year? That's a good question. There's a lot of good running backs that they're going to have the opportunity to do that. You know, obviously Gunnar Morton got off that to the quick start. You know, but I think that when Matt Clayton comes back from his concussion, I think that, you know, they're going to split carries a little bit, and I think that's kind of going to neutralize each other a little bit. So I'm not sure if I'm going to go with him. When you look at the Travis Levy's, the Marcus Vincent's, the Adrian Fields Platts, I'm going to go with either Marcus Vincent or Travis Levy, because I don't know, first and foremost, how much they're going to have to split with anybody else. That's key to that. I think that obviously Robert Brown is going to be in the backfield a little bit. There's a few other running backs that Marcus is going to have to kind of split with, but I think they're going to be the main running backs on their teams, you know, getting the carries and things like that. So I think one of those two guys are going to hit 1,000 yards. I think that, you know, you can look at week six, week seven, and they should be hovering around 900, 1,000 yards. I think that Travis is probably going to break off a few 200-yard, you know, gains coming up here, and definitely Marcus is probably going to continue that trend too. So those two guys definitely take a look at. What do you have, anybody, Damon?
Actually, I'm going with Ty Hebron from Richard Montgomery, and the only reason I hesitate to pick Vincent or Levy is, especially in Damascus's case, they're going to have several running clocks this year. Vincent's going to be off the field pretty early in several games, and I expect a similar thing, but probably less games for Levy at Sherwood. But for Rich Montgomery, they're going to have to fight pretty much every game, all game, and I expect Ty Hebron to play a big role in that. So
yeah, that's a good pick. That's a good pick. That's a really good pick.
Just in terms of personnel and each team's schedule.
Right. Competition and everything.
I think Hebron from Richard Montgomery might be the first to get to 1,000 yards. Now, once the season is all said and done, I think all three of those players will be in the top five rushers in Montgomery County. In what order, that remains to be seen. But in terms of who gets to 1K first, I'm going with Hebron.
Right, nah, that's a really good pick. That's a really good pick. Yeah, he's a great running back, and he's definitely going to have the opportunities based off of who he's playing and everything, that he's definitely going to have that opportunity to do that. Next question, and this is a really good question that we're going to go with. Rhett Neck. Let me emphasize, Rhett Neck. 8117, asked a question out of Blake, Whitman, Watkins Mill, which are contenders and which are possible pretenders. It's kind of early to kind of determine right now. Blake and Whitman probably had the two most impressive wins out of the three. We kind of expected Watkins Mill to dominate Frederick, but they dominated Frederick so bad that you have to pay attention to it. Marco Grant is showing why he's going to be a guy that we're going to talk about as Smoko MVP and everything. I think that if you're talking about contenders for the playoffs, I'm going to have to go with Blake Watkins Mill, because when you look at it, they probably have the best chance to make the playoffs because of the division that they're in. So I'm going to have to go with them based off of, schedule and the division that they're in and everything like that. Whitman, they have QO, Northwest, Blair's actually on that side too. So they got those, and then also RM, so that's pretty much what it is. And so it has nothing really to do with Whitman per se, but more so, what they have to go up against just to get into the playoffs. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. In terms of contenders, it's definitely Blake and Watkinsville. They both came away with victories in week one and are in the driver's spot so far in the region, which is 3A South, I think.
Right.
3A South. But Whitman, not to say that they're a lesser team, but they just have more uphill climb when it comes to making the playoffs. As you mentioned, you got QO, you got Northwest, you got Blair, you got Richard Montgomery, which were the four playoff teams from last year. And then you have other teams to contend with for just getting in, with teams like Clarksburg, who got off to a good start. And then a couple other teams that might pop up and surprise you, like BCC or Wooten. We don't know. We'll see as the season progresses.
Right.
Even Gaithersburg, based off of how they played Northwest, they're definitely not a pushover. Mm-hmm. Whitman definitely just has more of an uphill climb. Not to say that they can't make it, but the road is definitely easier for Watkins Mill and Blake.
Absolutely. And we're going to get to this question, because this is the hot button question. This is the question that kind of sparked all hell on the board or whatever, right?
Uh-huh.
My man Naminu, he's a freshman, sophomore poster. And we all knew this was coming, Damon, but my man stuck his neck out there, and he goes, a win is a win, but my question is with key and all uppercase and key, all uppercase letters, key QO starters out, and the fact that Damascus wasn't able to pour it on QO, is that a sign that Damascus is not as strong as last season, or is QO better, deeper team this season? Okay. So basically what he's alluding to is, QO was without a few of their starters, namely Fofi Bazzi and Marvin Beander, two D1 players that will be playing on Saturday next season. They also lost a few other guys during the week to suspension as well, and so a lot of people in QO land believe that if those guys were on the field, that it would have been different. And do I believe, and first I'm going to address his question when it comes on to, you know, do I feel like this is a sign that the master's not as strong? I mean, let's just be real. He lost Jake Funk, right? Like, you're not going to be as strong as you were when you lose Jake Funk. Jake Funk is one of the greatest running backs in the state's history. Yo, they're not as strong. You know, like, they, you know, anytime you lose a player like that, you're probably not going to be as strong. But they, I think what they showed was they got a lot of depth. Marcus Vincent is going to definitely step into that role where he's going to become the main player, and he's going to be able to carry that team just as well as, you know, as Jake did last year. So to answer that question, yes and no. I think that Damascus has the opportunity to be even more dynamic than they were last year, because last year it was pretty much you knew what you're going to get. Now, that one dynamic was awesome, right? But, you know, this year I think, and you saw it in the game, there's a lot of different things that Damascus was doing. A lot of different players were touching the ball. So I think as the season goes on, I think that, that Damascus is going to be a really dangerous team. QO is definitely deeper this season. I was impressed with QO's depth. They went, I mean, those kids were the, you know, were the third, fourth, and fifth wide receiver out there catching touchdowns, right? And they all looked good. It wasn't, you know, that obvious, man, like, that kid shouldn't be in the game kind of thing. These were kids that they were really good athletes. It was impressive. It was impressive. QO was impressive to me. That's why, honestly, full disclosure, I kept them at number two. You know, I had no reason really to drop them down because of the performance that they had. So with all that being said, about the actual game itself and whether, you know, QO having their players would have affected it, of course it would have affected it. There's no way you could say that a team not having two Division I football players didn't have some effect on the game. Now, I'm not going to go as far as to say, you know, QO would have won the game, right? Because that's just disrespectful to Damascus. But for you, for anybody to say that that wouldn't have had any effect on the game, having two Division I players, you're either saying that there's something else that Damascus, you know, had up their sleeve, or you just don't really respect the abilities of the two players that we're talking about, which is Fofi Bazzi and Marvin Beander. Now, if that's the if that's your argument that they're just not that good or not that much better than their counterparts that actually played, then, you know, that's a discussion for, you know, another day. But if you believe what I believe, and I think you, Damon, believe that there are great players, there are legit Division I football players, then yes, it would have had an effect on the game. But I still think that either way, Damascus would have found a way to win the game some way, somehow. That's what Damascus does. Like I said, they're the New England Patriots of Montgomery County football and everything. So I think that Damascus, they knew fully well that both kids would have been playing. They have one of the best coaching staffs in the county, in the state. So I'm not going to say, hey, look, Damascus won the game. There's no doubt about it. And if the two kids would have played, I don't know if what would have happened. We're talking about imaginary stuff right here, but it definitely would have been a different game. You know, it definitely would have changed some things. But I still think that Damascus probably could have found a way to win. So that's kind of how I feel about it. But QO has every right to feel like, you know, if they had older horses, that they could have won the game. So I already know, you know, I'm just gonna let you go. Go ahead.
I mean, yeah, you pretty much said it all. I mean, it comes, so to answer this question, is Damascus not as strong as last year? Based off of that first game, I mean, we still have 10 to go and then some. I have to say no. Last year's team was one of the best Damascus Swarm and Hornet teams ever. I mean, just the proof is in the pudding. Go back and look at any game, literally any game, and they dominated every single opponent that they faced.
Right.
Outside of the regular season matchup with Seneca, which I still say they dominated.
dominated. It just wasn't reflected in the score. But right. if you look, did drill
they
down
controlled
and,
the game.
Into the stats,
they controlled
they dominated.
The game. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's going to be hard for any future Damascus team to live up to the 2015 version.
Right.
As for the second part of that question, is QO deeper? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
The proof was on Friday night.
Mm-hmm.
You have twos and threes and in some cases fours on the field and doing a respectable job.
Right.
So, yeah. Now, I'm right with you. I'm definitely not going to say if those starters were playing, if the outcome would have been any different,
mm-hmm.
but I tell you what, the game was already exciting. It would have been one for the ages if they were in. I'll just leave it at that.
Right, right, right. Absolutely. Yeah, that's pretty much, you know, how I feel about it. You know, like, yeah. Games are they're their own entities, you know, these football games. And you cannot, it's irresponsible for anybody just to say that if you plug, and especially football being the ultimate team game, it's irresponsible for anybody to say that, you know, you plug one or two people into a football game that this team definitely would have won. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just irresponsible, right? But, you know, it's clear, and like I said again, if you don't feel like, you know, Fofi Bazzi and Beander and others not playing affected the game, that means you just don't feel like they're great players. But, you know, I feel like they're great players. I believe you, Damon, feel like they're great players. So anytime you insert a great player or great players into a situation, yes, the dynamic will be different. Damascus, at the very least, would have to respect those players, have to, you know, change up their game plan to, you know, to kind of react, be doing. So that's all it is. Okay, so we're at the stage, at the part of the show that, you know, scares me and Damon the most, and it's the pick'em part. Okay. This, you know, obviously we got a few wrong last week. You know, a few people let us know about it on Twitter. Keep tweeting us if we get it wrong. So we're gonna make sure, we're gonna lock in. We did a little bit of research this time, a little bit more research. We always do research, but we did a little bit more research this time into these teams, and I feel pretty good about my picks, Damon. How do you feel about your picks
from last week?
Last week's behind us. We're not looking at that. We're going forward. You know, today's a new day. It's a new week, fresh start. How you feeling? Like, do you think that these picks that you're gonna, you know, bestow upon us are, you know, picks that you know, are strong, well thought out picks?
No, I'm not feeling confident at all. There are definitely some teams that I think are better.
Right.
And I initially thought, now I we'll get a better idea going into week two, but yeah, right. My confidence is a little shook.
I'm praying to God right now. So here we're gonna we're just gonna go into it. We're you know, look, you gotta go just dive into the deep end. We're going in first game, BCC at Blair. This is actually a little bit more interesting week two than it was, you know, the beginning of the season, because BCC's performance versus Sherwood opened some eyes, you know, had people paying attention to them. Blair obviously is a not, I don't even think you can call them up and coming anymore. They're here, they've arrived. What do you think about this game, Damon? Who do you think is going to win the score?
I got Blair coming out with victory in their home opener. However, based off of BCC's performance versus Sherwood last week, I think they'll hang in there for about 2-3 quarters before Blair breaks it open. I have Blair winning 38-21.
Okay. Yeah, I think that Blair is going to win as well. I'm going to go with Blair 27-14. Let's go to the next game. Clarksburg is heading over to Sherwood. Sherwood, as I mentioned before, you know, struggled a little bit with BCC, but Travis Levy again showed why he's Travis Levy. 185 yards, you know, 3 touchdowns, all that good stuff. Who do you think is going to win this game, Damon?
This is going to be the quintessential old school Montgomery County football game. If you're a fan of line play and running backs, this is the matchup you definitely want to check out. Both teams had their struggles in week one, but were able to correct them in game and come away with the W.
Mm-hmm.
So I am going with Sherwood to pull out the victory in a hard-fought, somewhat close game. I have Sherwood winning 22-16.
I got Sherwood winning again. Two, I think Clarksburg is going to play them tough. But, you know, I think that the home crowd at Sherwood is going to propel them forward. I got Sherwood winning 32-21. We're going to go to Damascus, Rockville. Rockville had a really good win over Walter Johnson last week. Damascus, obviously, you know, the win of the season so far versus QL. Who do you got in this game, Damon?
The Damascus train keeps on rolling.
Yeah.
I don't think this will be too close of a game. I got Damascus getting the victory on the road at Rockville, 35-7.
Yeah, I got Damascus as well. I got Damascus 49-24. I think that Rockville is going to score some points late in the game versus some of the twos and threes at Damascus, and, you know, make the score kind of respectable. Einstein going to Churchill. This game is 2-0-1 teams, but clearly Einstein showed with Christian Greaves, one of the most explosive players in the state of Maryland, that they can give anybody hell. So where do you see this game, Damon? How do you see this game playing out?
I think these are somewhat evenly matched teams. Mm-hmm. One team is going to come away with the W, and I do believe that'll be the Einstein Titans. Even in the loss to Rich Montgomery, Einstein put up some huge numbers. I expect that to be even bigger this week. So I got Einstein 45, Churchill 6.
Yeah, I got Einstein 31, and I got Churchill 10. We're gonna move on to one of our favorite, you know, things, the private school public school matchup. We got Landon going to Whitman. Whitman coming off one of the biggest surprise wins of the season so far, beating Paint Branch at Paint Branch. Do you think that they're going to carry this? Do you think they're going to carry this momentum over, Damon?
Of course. I'm always going to ride with the public school.
Of course.
So yeah, I don't care if they're playing DeMatha. I'm picking the public school.
Right.
So with that being said, especially if Matt Clayton is back on the field, I got Whitman winning 21-14.
I got Whitman winning 17-10. We're going to go, and, you know, if it wasn't for Seneca Valley Northwest, this game might have been the game of the week. Paint Branch is going to Blake. Blake is really feeling the wave right now. They're all in with the football program. I'm really excited to get over to Blake and see what's going on. Paint Branch, I mean, we just mentioned it, had a devastating loss at home last week. I think that they're definitely going to try to bounce back this week versus a rival. This is Blake's time, man. Like, if they're going to beat Paint Branch, this is the time. And they had an impressive win versus Springbrook, and I think that this is just going to be something that, we're going to be talking about later on. We're either going to be talking about Paint Branch getting back on track and going forward, or Blake, you know, continuing their rise to to relevancy, basically. So who do you got in this game?
I am 100% on the Blake bandwagon.
Mm-hmm.
I was thoroughly impressed by their victory at Springbrook last week, and combined with the upset that Pink Branch had, I think momentum is heavily in Blake's favor, and I think they'll follow through on it. I got Blake winning 35-21.
Yeah, I got Blake winning as well. I think that Blake is going to salvage themselves and really send a message to Watkins Mill, saying, hey, you know, you're not the only team over here on this side of 3A that can do some things. So, actually, I got Blake winning 28-27. It's going to be a really good game. I think that both teams are going to be, you know, up and down the field. But ultimately, I think that Blake is going to pull it out 28-27. We're going to go to Springbrook and we're going to go to Wooten. Wooten had a good win versus Kennedy last week. Springbrook, tough loss versus Blake. Do you think that Springbrook bounces back this week and beats Wooten this week, Damon?
Absolutely. I'm still a believer in what's going on down in Springbrook. They just ran into a buzzsaw last week. I think they'll be able to right the ship versus Wooten this week. Even though Wooten looked pretty good last week, it was versus Kennedy, so you have to take the performance with a grain of salt. We'll have a better idea of what the Patriots squad looks like in their home opener versus the Blue Devils, but as it stands right now, I'm going with Springbrook 28-24.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Springbrook, and I got this game high scoring 31-44-31. Watkins, and this is another really intriguing game right here. Watkins Mill is going to Gaithersburg. Watkins Mill hasn't beaten Gaithersburg in a long, long time. Who do you got in this game, Dame?
They were definitely one of my preseason picks to make some noise. And I'm going to continue to ride with them in week two as they travel to Gaithersburg. Gaithersburg had a good showing last week versus Northwest, but unfortunately, I don't think they'll have the juice to take down the Wolverines. I got Watkins Mill in a big win, 35-14.
I got Watkins Mill 20-17. I think that, you know, that Gaithersburg is going to try to, you know, get a game-winning, game-tying field goal, and I think they're going to fall short. Wheaton going to Poolsville. Damon, who we got win this one?
This is, for me, definitely an intriguing game. I don't know how or why, but over the years, this has been a very good, even matchup between these two schools from opposite sides of the county.
Right.
I've been present for a couple of games, and honestly, regardless of the team's record, they've been some of the most entertaining, exciting games
I've
been to over the past few years. Wheaton surprised me and you by pulling off the win over Magruder.
Mm-hmm.
So it looks like they were definitely able to replace their all-county running back from last year and keep the ball rolling. Poolsville, unfortunately, ran into the juggernaut that is the Seneca Valley Screaming Eagles, but they played a good game, all things considered.
Right.
So this is a tough one, but only due to the fact that Poolsville is playing at home, I got them pulling off the victory over the Wheaton Knights in an extremely close game, 13-14.
Mm, okay. Yeah, I actually got Wheaton winning 12-7.
Okay.
Yeah, real close game, real hard fought game. Okay, we're going to go to Kennedy versus RM. RM clearly is the superior team in this one, but do you think that Kennedy has anything that can make this game interesting?
My heart goes out to the Kennedy coaches and kids. I know you guys are working extremely hard, but this RM is still riding high. I got Richard Montgomery with the easy victory, 41-7. I think Kennedy will, their time will come at some point this season. It just won't be this weekend.
Yeah, I got RM 49-0. Northwood is going to Magruder. Magruder is trying to rebound from the loss versus Wheaton in week one. How do you see this game, Damon?
Yep, I see the Colonels getting their first win of the season over Northwood, 35-0.
I actually think that this is going to be a somewhat decent game. I think that Magruder's definitely going to win, but I think, you know, Northwood's going to put up a little bit of a fight. I got this game coming down to, you know, turnovers, defense, things like that, some special team play. So I'm going to go with Magruder 24, and I'm going to go with Northwood 14. QO and Walter Johnson, my goodness.
52-7.
What did you say?
52-7. QO, sorry.
Yeah. I'm gonna go with QO 48-0.
I just want to let y'all know, put some respect on my name.
Put some respect.
Put some respect.
Put some respect.
Put some respect.
Put some respect when you mention my name.
All right. We're nearing the end of the show. I know, thank you guys for staying, you know, through this long show that we have here. It's the new craze, put some respect on his name. We got two really good players this week. Damon, why don't you start us off?
So my player for the put some respect on my name segment in week two is the junior quarterback from the Wooten Patriots, Grant Saylor. Mm-hmm. He had an outstanding game last week, taking down the Kennedy Cavaliers 39-14. He's a kid to watch out for, especially since this is his second year running the show over in Rockville. He's 6 feet, 174 pounds, and, you know, the sky's the limit for this young quarterback. He definitely deserves to be mentioned among some of the top quarterbacks in the county. He was able to, matter of fact, he led the county last week in terms of passing yards with 270 yards. So if no other reason alone, that's good enough for me to get the put some respect on my name winner for week two.
Right. Now that's a great pick. The kid I'm going to be going with is Gunnar Morton. This kid really put the team on his back when the team lost, you know, arguably their best player. Matt Clayton was out with a head injury with a concussion. This kid stepped up, 29 carries, 224 yards, 4 touchdowns in a huge win versus Paint Branch. I mean, what else do you have to say? I mean, that's one of the best performances we're going to see all season long. And this kid really showed why we need to talk about him a lot more. We need to put some respect on his name. So we're going to go with Gunnar Morton. I'm going to go with Gunnar Morton. Put some respect on his name.
Yo, for real, Gunnar Morton is a babyface assassin.
Yeah.
Go to his huddle page and look at that profile picture. don't let that schoolboy innocent look fool you. He will truck you.
Right. So, you know, I think maybe that threw Paint Branch off a little bit. I don't know.
You know. They were like, hey, who's this kid?
Right. You know,
and he just ran
straight over him. Like, you know what I'm saying? They knew for, you know, after that game, he was a grown man after that. So, you
mm-hmm.
know, yeah. So, I mean, yeah, Gunnar Morton, I'm going to put some respect on your name, man. We're definitely going to try to talk about you a lot more on the podcast, on Twitter, and everywhere else. All right, Damon, so we're at the end of the show. You know, thank you so much for staying with us. Is there anything else that you want to say?
Just as usual, if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, you can get at me at Nomad Anderson on Twitter, or you can reach me on the message board, mocofb.com. Screen name is Nomad. So if you have anything to say, anything you'd like us to talk about on the podcast, just let us know. Otherwise, enjoy the games on Friday night.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, and see you next week.